Welcome to the fourth webinar in the series that the Department of Biotechnology is organizing in association with DBT Wellcome Trust India Alliance to highlight the role played by DBT, its autonomous institutes and public sector undertakings in mitigating the COVID-19 pandemic. While the first webinar in the series had Dr. Renu Swarup, Secretary DBT, Dr. Alka Sharma, Advisor DBT, and Dr. Kavita Singh, Mission Director, National Biopharma Mission, BIRAC, as experts to discuss DBT's multi-pronged research strategy and action plan to address COVID-19. The second webinar, which focused on how the DBT is leveraging the startup and industry ecosystem to respond to the COVID-19 pandemic and how startups can be a part of efforts, we had with us Dr. Manish Diwan, Head Sped BIRAC, Dr. Taslimarif Sayyed, CEO CCAMP, and Dr. Jitendra Sharma, CEO Andhra Pradesh MedTech Zone as our experts. The third webinar with Dr. Shomitro Das, Director, National Institute of Biomedical Genomics, Dr. K. Pangaraj, Director, Center for DNA Fingerprinting and Diagnostics, and Dr. M.K. Bhatt, Director of National Center for Cell Sciences, Pune, as panelists, highlighted the efforts of NIBMG, CDC, and NCCS in the development of diagnostics, vaccines, and drugs. So, I'll just share a few housekeeping announcements with you all. The webinar is being recorded, so if anyone misses out on today's webinar, they can always follow the webinar through the recording, which will be uploaded on both DBT as well as India Alliance's YouTube channels. You may drop your message or questions in the question box anytime during the webinar. And in case the webinar ends abruptly due to any kind of technical issues, please join back using the same registration link you just used. DBT's autonomous institutes are actively involved in countries' fight against COVID-19 through the development of diagnostics, vaccines, and drugs. Some of the institutes are also training the medical professionals in collecting the samples. As covering the vast work of all the autonomous institutes in a webinar is not going to be possible, in this webinar, we will learn more about the efforts of National Institute of Immunology, Institute of Life Sciences, and Institute of Bioresources and Sustainable Development.
Please, Dikin.
More on the efforts of these institutes, we are delighted to be joined with Dr. Amulya Panda, Director of National Institute of Immunology, New Delhi, Dr. Ajay Kumar Pareda, Director of Institute of Life Sciences, Bhubaneswar, and Professor Pulok Mukherjee, Director of Institute of Bioresources and Sustainable Development, IMPART. So on that note, I would like to first invite Dr. Amulya Panda shed light on the efforts of NII to mitigate the pandemic. Over to you, Dr. Panda.
Yeah. Shall we go to motors?
Okay, I'm audible.
Yes.
Go to the first slide. Go to the first slide. You have gone too much fast. Go to the first slide. Okay, so should I start now?
Yes, please.
Okay. Good morning to you all, and thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. What I'll do is, because I represent National Institute of Immunology, and I'm sure during this pandemic, everybody know what is immunology and immunity. I thought I'll tell you a little bit, a brief description about this corona candidate vaccine. I'm sure you all must be reading, but what I want to tell you is, read authentic information. Don't read it from newspaper to tell. I'll try to give you some gist of what my understanding about a vaccine. And of course, I'll tell you about what NII is doing, particularly on different aspects as we have been discussing for last 4 months. Next slide. Can you change? Okay. I think everybody know, but let me tell you to all, vaccine is the most wonderful medical intervention of the last 3 centuries. And please remember, there are difference between vaccine and drug. Drug is given to a person when he is sick. Vaccine is always given to a healthy person. And vaccine is always given in single dose or maybe two dose, and it works for the whole life. And most of the time, the vaccine, the successful vaccines, works on two principles. It has neutralizing antibody, which against that pathogen. The most important thing of vaccine is it gives memory antibody. So if a vaccine or any candidate vaccine is not giving memory antibody, something like foot and mouth disease, it doesn't give memory, you have to give the vaccine every year. That is not actually a vaccine. A vaccine is like smallpox or maybe TT, DT. You give the vaccine, get protected for lifelong. And how it works, a vaccine has three important components: antigen, adjuvant, and kinetics. In antigen, I have written two parameters, shift and drift. Please remember, all successful vaccines which are available in the market, whether it is a TT, DT, or pertussis, the antigen is fixed. It's not like HIV. It keeps changing the sequence or it keeps changing the species. The shift and drift are important. It's something like your target should be fixed, then only you can develop a vaccine. Precisely that's why we don't have a vaccine against HIV. We don't have a vaccine against flu. The adjuvants like alum and other things are given to make humoral or cellular response depending on the requirement. In last 2 years, it has come now, apart from antigen and adjuvant, the kinetics of the release is important because that governs germinal center, that controls somatic hypermutation, SHM, germinal center formation and somatic hypermutation tells whether the plasma cell and B cells will be memory cell so that you get lifelong antibody response. Unless you have these things, a vaccine will be a candidate vaccine. It is not a vaccine to be used in the market. Next. Next slide. It's very simple, but it is very difficult to make. In general, a vaccine takes 10 to 12 years. You see, 85, when the HIV pandemic came, the same group of people who are advising, they told in 1985, the vaccine will be available in 2 years. 36 years has gone. We are still searching for the vaccine. We are just beginning to understand what is neutralizing titer. That's that complex. Dengue fever was detected in 1943. It took 75 years to make a vaccine. Till now, we have no vaccine for SARS and MERS. Flu vaccine is still seasonal. Even though it started with Spanish flu, last 100 years people are trying. We didn't have a flu vaccine. The only success is that a mumps vaccine, which was made in 4 years in a record time. So probably if everybody follow, hopefully a corona vaccine will come in 2 to 3 years or 2 years. Next slide. Next slide, please. Yeah, I don't want to go in detail, but these are the five vaccines. All you have been listening, RNA vaccine, DNA vaccine, viral vaccine, and the last one is viral vector. But see, all are published in New England Journal of Medicine, Nature Communication, Lancet. Last week, the Russian vaccine came in Lancet. They all are showing immunogenicity and little bit of neutralizing titer. Nobody has shown memory antibody response yet. That means all these five top vaccines, which are all we are talking, are 50% successful because none of them has shown memory antibody response. And if you are reading, read New England Journal of Medicine, Nature Communication, Lancet Science, read them. But if you want to really know what is the gist of this, read the editorial comments. That is the actual, because all these five companies are pushing their own, and all of them are not true. I'll show you what the editor of New England Journal of Medicine wrote when these were published in, that is worth reading. Next slide. Next slide, please. Can't tell again. Next slide. Yeah, this is what published in New England Journal of Medicine in July. And this is the editorial. Look at the challenges it has written. Look at these yellow points. the challenge, this is how the clinical trial go back. This is how the clinical trial go from preclinical to phase one, phase two, phase three. Look at the yellow danger signal she put 1 month back. Manufacturing a quality product, and most importantly, the phase three trials. Phase three trials is taken at a place with huge population with varied genetic diversity. What these reports which are published, like the Russian report, it is based on military personnel who are healthy people. Whether they are producing neutralizing titer has no meaning, whether a person who is sick, 60-year-old, or for the child. So these are things to be understood. And over the years, over the last 6 months, very complex thing has come. I'll just summarize in one slide how dilemma we have for making this vaccine. Next slide. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is one I have summarized. The vaccine doesn't induce long-lasting antibody response. That is the greatest danger. Number two, people who are infected, many people reported they don't have antibody. In fact, a new term has come. Just like in physics, there is dark matter, there is immunological dark matter. Number third, people who are infected, who recovered, they don't get pneumonia in second infection, but their body produces the virus. That means he can infect others. That give a doubt whether vaccine will be successful. Please remember the fourth point. People who are dying with corona are not dying because of corona. This is important. The comorbidity is much, much important. And last one, like Ajay and Dr. All NIBAGM have sequenced, let's hope that the virus doesn't become very lethal. If that becomes, we are in a difficult time. But if you summarize, you know, let's hope for the best that some vaccine one day will come, but be prepared for the worst. With this, I will see what we are doing. Go to the next slide. We do a lot of things. We do on vaccine development using protein, which I'll speak myself. I do myself. Dr. Pushkar Sharma is producing those stable clone in mammalian cell line. I do in E. coli. Antibody-based therapy is done by Dr. Devendra Sehgal. Virus neutralization assay is done by Nimesh. Training of, we are starting with Gates Foundation to train MLTs and lab technicians how to do RT-PCR. We are doing that. Basically, we are producing next generation diagnostic people who can do or open small shops or labs to do RT-PCR diagnosis. We are developing a BSL-3 facility and a non-human primate facility in NI. This is done by Binay, Rajesh, and our animal house expert. The training part is taken care by Binay and Rahul, and transgenic mice model is developed by, is in collaboration with Subir. I'll not talk about that, but I'll just talk about what protein-based vaccine we are working and what is our result in next 4 years. Let me tell you, we are in an educational institute. I am not going to show you something what others are doing, but we do something different. I do a E. coli-based protein vaccine, and I will update you what data we have got. Next slide. Next slide. Now the slides are just to screen. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is the vaccine. We have been expressing RBD portion in E. coli because that is our strength. We have E. coli express RBD protein, and we conjugate to CRMTT, and we use dry powder alum and nanoparticles of NII, PLA nanoparticle to deliver them. So this is our concept. We express the protein in E. coli, use it with alum and other adjuvant along with our nanoparticle. Next one. Next slide. This is what I gave the deliverable. In fact, May we started cloning, June we got the culture, and we started immunizing in July. We are now in the middle of animal immunization and memory antibody titer. I hope complete memory response and antibody will be available by December 2020. Next. That is slow in changing the slides. Next slide, please. Yukti, next slide. Yeah, so all I want to tell is we have clones and a system to express most of the protein, RBD, capsid, S1, TMPRSS. We have a HEK cell line expressing mammalian express RBD, and we have developed a conjugate process for conjugating coronavirus protein to TT, DT, TLRs. We have nanoparticle. Our expression level is around 1 to 2 grams per liter. Anybody wants to take this protein, RBD, capsid, S1, TMPRSS, just write to me and we'll send you the protein. No issue. We have started immunization data in BALB/c mice, and I will show you some of our data. This is the protein, very pure protein. We have done all biophysical. Go to the next. This is done. Go to the next. This is the protein. It's good purity and stable. Go to the next. Next slide. This is the ELISA data after 28 days. We did a dose response, but if you see what you want to see, that the immunogenicity is very consistent. It is not because of something. We have taken 200, 400, 800, 36,000, 64,000. As you keep on diluting, the OD comes down, means these are all antibody. All I want to say that the RBD or RBD with alum, RBD nanoparticle, and different doses give high antibody titer. Remember, these are immunogenic titer, not neutralizing titer. Next slide. Yeah, these are T cell response, and you can see IgG2B, you can see the different kinetics on 28 days and 42 days. The titer is maintained. Next slide. I'll just wind up. Next slide, please. So what we did is, once we know that this titer is coming, we send our sera to THSTI, and thankfully THSTI has developed a virus neutralizing assay, pseudovirus assay, as well as other assay, and they did the assay for us. In fact, few sample only last week they did the virus neutralization assay. Next slide. Change the slide, please. So this is virus neutralization. No, go back. Okay, I can, all I want to say that this antibody titer is neutralizing. I have confirmed it. You could see in 20 days titer, the titer was not neutralizing, but the 40 days, 42 day sample, you see all the samples are neutralizing at 80 dilution. We are repeating this experiment. Hopefully, we'll be able to refine. But all I want to say that at this stage, so 10 microgram of protein, when you immunize with alum, produce titer, which is neutralizing. And if you calculate, in 1 liter, we get around 1 gram. So it is 10,000 doses per liter of E. coli culture. It will be damn cheap if it shows the light of the day. Next one. Next slide. So we want to repeat the experiment. We are developing a preclinical protocol, virus immunization. In fact, I have a non-human primate facility, which we are now trying to do the monkey experiment. And currently I am talking to industry who can take this technology. I have filed last 4 months, 5 patents on different aspect of corona vaccine, and 5 granted patents on our things. So we are negotiating with industry who can take our platform technology. With this, I will end, but being a DBT institute, I will end up with a slogan and with an advice to all of you. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yukti, next slide. Yeah, this is what we must always do. Our immunity is our right. We must protect ourselves, but being educated, being in DBT, we must protect the society immunity. That is our duty. So do the right duty. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Panda. That was a very insightful presentation. I would now like to invite Dr. Ajay Pareda, Director of Institute of Life Sciences, Bhubaneswar, to discuss the efforts of DBT ILS in mitigating the pandemic. Over to you, Dr. Pareda.
Am I visible at the audio? Are the slides are visible?
No, we can't see the slides. Yeah.
Is it okay now?
We can go on full screen mode. Yeah, perfect.
Okay. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to be on this webinar. What I'll do is that in the next 15 minutes, I'll just give you a glimpse of what is the activities at ILS Bhubaneswar we are doing in relation to the COVID-19. But prior to that, before that, I'd also like to introduce, as many of you are aware about the Institute of Life Science, but many of you may not be. So I think Institute of Life Science is a 30-year-old organization which was established by the state government, but later in 2003 it became an autonomous institute of Department of Biotechnology. Our mandate is betterment of human health and welfare, and we have four different divisions called infectious disease, cancer biology, genetic and autoimmune disease, and plant and microbial biotechnology. What we do, like all other institutions, we focus on research and development, translation and product development, then outreach and capacity building, as well as partnership. The work at ILS is being done by 20 faculties. We have more than 20 PDFs or postdoctorals, 120 registered PhD fellows, as well as about 100 project staff. Just to give a glimpse of activities, what last year we have done, I think we have published more than 47 research papers. About 10 students has been obtained their PhD. And I don't want to go into this, but at the same time, we have developed a lot of collaboration, we have licensed the technology, and also we have three patents filed and two patents granted, and a lot of publications which are in peer-reviewed publication journal. Now, specifically coming to COVID-19, I think we'll start with the COVID testing, what we did here. In April 2020, when the state government approached ILS to do the testing for the COVID-19 samples, we obtained the approval from the Department of Biotechnology as well as Indian Council of Medical Research, and the DBT approval came on 10th of April, while ICMR approval came on 13th of April, and 14th April we started COVID-19 testing at ILS with a dedicated team from ILS involving about more than 50 people. So what Ajay mentioned, that on 14th April 2020, ILS started testing with about 44 samples. And till yesterday, we had tested something about 88,000 samples, which are collected from 26 of the 30 districts from Orissa. The samples are provided by the government of Orissa. And this contributed about 20% of the sample tested in the state using RT-PCR. And the ILS LAID hub, which is supported by Department of Biotechnology, have conducted so far 260,000 tests. Until date, ILS has reported about 3,600 positive cases, and this has been very well appreciated. The effort has been appreciated by one and all within the state as well as outside the state. Now, coming to the research focus, I think we are focusing on virus detection, sequencing of the virus genome, understanding the immune system that fight the virus, therapeutic as well as the animal models, which I'll go briefly explain the entire all the work which we have done. Starting with the COVID-19 virus genomics, our major aim is to identify the viral strains prevalent in Orissa population, and also to investigate whether there is any difference in between the symptomatic and asymptomatic case. So far, we have sequenced 225 sequences, which is a part of the Pan-DBT 1000 Viral Genome Sequencing Initiative. All strains were either from Institute of Life Science or our partner institute, RMRC Bhubaneswar, And we are also in the process of 96 more virus genome sequencing, because the 225 sequences which has been done, they were done during March to June, and this 96 more virus genome will be after June to August. And what our major observation is that all the five reported clades are found in low Odisha samples. And what is more promising is that like 20A and 20B are the most predominant clades, which 20C is very minor number. But what is interesting is that with the 1000 genome initiative, which we did with the pan-DBT effort, clade 20C was only present in Orissa samples and not in other clades. So what we presume is that this particular strain has lost its viability, or that is not being present in other locations. And you could also see during the sampling dates that the strain 20A and 20B, which predominated during the month of May and June, while these other strains were in the lower strains. We also did a phylogenetic analysis of all the genome analysis. But what is more important to find, you can see from this graph, on this particular phylogenetic tree, the red portions indicate the symptomatic cases. And what we could see is that in the clade 20B, which is of more recent incidence in Odisha population, the number of symptomatic cases are quite high. So more symptomatic cases in the clade 20B was reported, and that is primarily because of some of the mutations which has happened. And what we found, that one of the mutations, the D614G mutation, which resulted in, you can see the, from the CT value, the CT value started declining, or higher, lower CT values were observed. So that is, we could see that the mutation in the D614G clade, which resulted into the higher incidence of the cases. We also did a structural elucidation of this particular mutation. What you could find is that this is a D614, and it is a TRMPSS2. So if you could see in the normal thing, you know, you have interaction site, but in case of the mutated line, the interaction site is quite, I mean, enhanced interaction of this in this particular site has resulted in enhanced virus shedding. That is what we have been reporting for. And this has resulted in three publications, which are going to be published soon in the peer-reviewed journals. Now, coming to also, we're looking into the immune response to the SARS-CoV-2 in the Indian population. For that, we are taking asymptomatic cases with flu-like illness, and symptomatic which are not requiring even mild symptomatics. And then also, of course, we are taking the contact COVID patients as well as the COVID negative individuals. This to analyze that this, what are the type of, and in each cohort, we are taking about 20 to 30 people. Now, we also did this antibody titers. Look at the, for example, in the direct contacts of the RT-PCR positive patients, what you could see, higher COVID-specific antibodies, and that the high level of antibodies in the contact might be protective by neutralizing the virus in the respiratory tract. This is an interesting observation. At the same time, when we looked at the cytokine analysis, we showed that IP-10 and MCP-3 are the severity indicator, as you could see in the positive cases, then the contact cases, and in two time points, which analysis has been done. But when you look at MIF, MIP-1 alpha, IL-1 RA alpha, all these things are mostly the protective factors rather than the severity indicators. So this study is quite interesting. We are increasing the number of samples to see that this is a very significant finding from our side. We have also looked into the evidence of the fecal dissemination of the SARS-CoV-2 time. We did the comparison between the nasopharyngeal swabs as well as the rectal swabs. What you could find is that the dissemination do happen. There is a chance of fecal and oral transmission of the virus. Then optimum sanitary and hygienic measures should be adopted at all level. And our ongoing effort is to correlate the fecal spreading of the virus with the disease severity. And this has been a policy advocacy tool so that the state governments has taken adequate precautions for following the adequate sanitary and hygienic trends in the COVID hospitals as well as the COVID care centers. We are also looking at the metagenome profile or the microbiome profile of these samples to essentially correlate the alterations in the oral and gut microbe of the COVID SARS-CoV-2, both in symptomatic and asymptomatic patients. After doing all these things, we also thought that we'll develop some of the pure virus culture, which will be quite useful for developing, for promoting the research in COVID-19. So we have taken some of, this is the protocol we followed. We studied the cytopathic effect, looked into immunofluorescence of the cultured cells, and then they looked into the foci forming unit, and also we did the Western blot to identify what is the stability or what is the expressions of this particular thing. So as of today, ILS has established 17 virus cultures, and these are collected from different clades. As I mentioned, there are four major clades found in the Orissa isolates. And during the passage, different passages, we have also estimated the viral copies per number, as well as the qPCR results for the spike gene from passage 3 to 10. Optosum and all the strains have been studied. This shows that establishment of a stable virus cultures at Institute of Life Science representing different clades. So this is a useful resource which can be utilized by researchers all across, and we are free to share these resources with anybody who are interested in doing COVID research. In addition to that, we have also established a high-content, high-throughput screening system at ILS, which aims at, like for example, we are looking at the interferon assays, we are looking at the NF, the Kappa B assays, as well as we are looking at the GFP tagged virus assays, which for testing the plant extracts, formulations, derivatives, FDA-approved libraries, genome libraries, and small molecule libraries. As if we did a drug or the bioinformatic analysis of one of the FDA approved libraries, and out of which we have shortlisted about 53 potential candidates for doing the antiviral strategy. But again, we have, based on the experiment, we have shortlisted about 13. And of these, you could see that one or this has the broad range of effect, so that this could be a potential candidate for the antiviral. And we're also looking into the option of whether they can be treated, I mean, there can be therapeutic strategy, whether it is individually or in combination. At the same time, we also developed the animal models here, like Syrian golden hamster, as well as the, so this is an established model for SARS-CoV-2, and animal colonies already have been maintained in ILS. And we've also procured what you call K18-HSCU-2 transgenic mice, which is a human ACE2, the receptor used for severe acute to gain entry to the cell. This has already been acquired. And for these two models, which is animal models, can help in to study transmission, to understand pathogenesis, to evaluate potential therapeutics, and to evaluate vaccine candidates. To sum up, with all these efforts, we have also established a biorepository of well-characterized samples of COVID-19 patients, and this would promote the research and development efforts of the indigenous diagnostic and therapeutics. And in this case, we have both collections of virus, blood, and others like sputum, stool, oropharyngeal swabs, as well as urine, and strazentate. We have samples collected from 176 individual COVID-19 patients, of which 65 were symptomatics and 110 are asymptomatic. We collect 0 to 5 days and 8 to 10 days of genome. Then swabs have been collected from the 0 to 5 and 8 to 10 days of hospitalization. Urine and stools from 0 to 5 days of hospitalization. And also serums has been collected from 50 non-infected healthy persons, so as a comparison. So this is again going to be a major resource for promoting research and development in COVID-19. With all these things, I think I must share this, that LS is ready to establish the SARS-CoV-2 cultures and is ready for service-based testing of drugs and herbal extracts formulations in both in vitro and antivirals using cell culture models. So we are ready for antiviral activities, which could be a service mode. We can determine IC50, cytotoxicity, therapeutic index, plaque reduction assay, cytopathic effect. But for the mechanism of action studies and antiviral activity in vitro, in vivo, we would like to collaborate with anybody who is interested. So this I would request any of you who are interested in all this evaluation of your drug molecules, please feel to contact us and we'll help you to help. With this, this is a glimpse of the effort which ILS has carried out. I must thank Dr. Enu Swaram, Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, the Government of Orissa, particularly the Health and Family Welfare Department, our ICMR partner, RMRC, all the COVID hospitals from where the samples has been collected, NIBMG and the PAN DVT 1000 genome virus genome sequencing. But last not but the least, my faculty, students, and staff at ILS, who with a smiling face did their untiring and inspiring efforts at the time of COVID pandemic. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Parida. That was a very helpful presentation. We, on that note, would like to invite the third and the last speaker for today's webinar, Professor Pulok Mukherjee, Director of Institute of Bioresources and Sustainable Development, IMFAL. Over to you, Professor Mukherjee. We can go to the full screen mode. I think you are on mute. Let me just. Yes, Professor Mukherjee.
Okay. Can you hear me and see my screen?
We can hear you and can see your screen. Can we go to slideshow mode, please? Yeah, perfect. It's working well. Thanks.
Is it okay?
Yes. Okay. Please go ahead.
So, good morning, everybody. I would like to congratulate Dr. Parida and Dr. Panda for the work what is being performed at ILS and NII. This is really very nice to see that with the DBT family, we have been working on very different aspects and in several initiatives has been taken for COVID-19, this scenario in this pandemic, how best we can develop our own drug, our own vaccine, our own system for protecting ourselves and the society at large. So I'll highlight here some of the initiatives of IBSD to this COVID-19 pandemic situation. As to give you a brief, as you know that that IBSD is the Institute of Bioresource and Sustainable Development of Biotechnology, have the mission on bioresource development, their sustainable use through biotechnological intervention for the socio-economic growth of the region. And the head office is in Imphal, in Manipur, and we are also have our existence in IBSD in Sikkim, in Gangtok, in Mizoram, in Aizawl, and even in Meghalaya and Shillong as well. So actually I took charge as a director of this institute in February, and suddenly from March itself this pandemic started. And I'm very much thankful that my predecessor, Dr. Ajoy Parida, who was the director in charge, he really helped and is helping and supporting me in this whole activities together, and with our whole team here. I'll just highlight some of those activities on that, on the initiatives during this COVID, against this COVID-19, or for helping the society on that, how best we have worked on. Since lockdown one started, IBSD has been interacting and actively engaging with several COVID testing facilities of the Northeastern region. Like we are sharing the RT-PCR machine from the very beginning with other instrumentations in Meghalaya, in Manipur, particularly in the Jawaharlal Institute of Medical Science in Imphal, and also in the Regional Medical Sciences, the Institute in Regional Institute of Medical Science in Imphal as well, with all the machineries, and even IBSD's trained scientists have been helping all these COVID-19 testing facilities in JNIMS and RIMS. And in IBSD, in fact, we had with our IZOL IBSD, we have shared the RT-PCR machine to the Joram Medical College as well. And that by that way, they have doubled the testing facility, and our scientists there, they're helping in the Joram Medical College on a regular basis. And in fact, we have been sharing the consumables in several of this region, because as you know, that this is not a very, because of the lockdown and other reason as well, because of the communications, there are a lot many problems in getting the normal consumables even sometime with those centers. So we have been facilitating and providing technical support in all context. And in fact, we have set up the center ultimately of IBSD's own in collaboration with Jawaharlal Institute of Medical Science at the testing laboratory at Imphal, Manipur, which has been accorded the approval of ICMR on July 11, and it has initiated the independent testing facilities from there on, and it has been working to a high extent on in this context for a long time. And several more than 1,500 sample has been tested so far, and this has been a great addition for the state government of Manipur. And in fact, with our other facilities being created in with collaborations with Pasteur Institute, which is under process at Meghalaya, and same like an independent testing facility which was requested by the state government of Meghalaya, and we are in process of developing that one very soon. As you know that in the whole Northeast, DVT have created different facilities, and this is very excellent of the Department of Biotechnology to have different hubs here and developing all these things in different context, that that there are 32 DBT sponsored laboratories in all 8 NER states, which will serve as a spoke with IBSD as the hub, and these consultations with them has already been made in this particular context. So with this, I'll just tell you some of those activities which have been taken forward in this matter, and will highlight some of those, like say on specific activities like this phytopharmaceutical mission of IBSD, which is a traditional medicine inspired drug discovery from medicinal aromatic plants of the Northeast region. This is one of the specific mission program we have undertaken, and there are several activities we have started in this context. Like first was that documentations of the medicinal plants specifically which are having antiviral report from the traditional claim as well as from the scientific studies. And by that way, we have developed a 72 plants compendium, which will come up as one of its kind from DBT at IBSD, that as a compendium of the antiviral medicinal plants of Northeast region, on which we are in the final stage, developing that one with the Botanical Survey of India and many other people who are helping. Besides, we are also having Sikkim, Meghalaya, and Mizoram for the exploring the therapeutic potential of those medicinal plant in different way, which will definitely be exploring for different other diseases as well. So on this specifically antiviral plants, we have collected those plants, many of those which have been very well reported activities, and then those extracts will be being shared with ILS Bhubaneswar and this RCB Faridabad, and then by that way we want to have those, because we do not have the antiviral screening facility now established now, and we have with our sister institutes, with specifically both with these two institutes, we are exchanging the sample to explore those plants for the specific therapeutic activity. One point what I want to highlight here, that our major context is that when we talk about this phyto, one thing you know all now, that throughout the world, not only in India, everybody believes on medicinal plants and they're used. And this is a very unique thing what has happened. See, earlier those things were being taken based on the belief. Now, starting from everybody, from scientists, bureaucrats, politicians, everybody talk about the science on those medicinal plants when we are talking about the immunomodulation, immunoboosting activity, and so on. So here are two approaches. One is the reductionist approach, and one is the synergistic approach. Reductionist approach, you are getting a separate molecule, developing a drug. And on that context, we have got drugs like aspirin, Taxol, artemisinin for malaria, and Taxol for anti-cancer, and so many other, many molecules. But many of these traditional medicines or the herbal medicines, which is working based on the concept of government within the directive of Ayush or different other ways like Ayurveda or even traditional medicines, which are codified or non-codified, they all work by the synergistic mechanism. And this synergy need to be established, and that is one of the major motto what we are putting forward with our institutes, so that the bioresources can be developed, or can be explored rather, in a scientific way for developing their synergistic mechanism of action, so that people of other countries, they will have faith on the system and getting those as a drug, as like as TCM and other products, the traditional Chinese medicine and other product. So we are developing some trust areas in that, on which we have been working not only for antiviral medicinal plant but for other plant as well, starting from extracts and downstream processing, then bioassay guided isolation, enrichment of the therapeutically potent metabolites, their chemo profiling, marker analysis, safety evaluation, and then quality evaluation, safety documentation studies. And when we develop those things, then we'll go on the metabolomic studies, which will help to know more about the hard drive interaction, safety related quality issues, phytomarker development, and bioactive phytocomponents and their analysis, so as to explore the ethnopharmacology and ethnomedicine of this northeastern region, specifically, which is a biodiversity hotspot. And by that way, through this synergy and combinatorial synergy, we can definitely evaluate the therapeutic potentials of the drug. As Dr. Panda told very well, that vaccine is not a drug. Really, it can give the cure. And where we have been working not on vaccine, but we are trying to explore those bioresources which can give you some sort of therapeutic potentials, as like as that helping in developing the whole immunity, or even helping in protecting us from the disease. So with this clustering of the northeastern support, in fact, we have different testing facilities here in Northeast, like Meghalaya and this Sikkim, in Mizoram, and in Manipur. As we told, in Manipur, we have our own system of in the Jawaharlal Nehru Institute of Medical Science, in collaboration with them. The system has been working as a DBT IBSD COVID COVID-19 testing laboratory. So we thank all our staff and students who have been working tirelessly with that center. After its inception, as you know that in this region, there are a lot of limitations, but in fact, overcoming those all limitations, this Corona warriors, I should say, they have been working and helping the institute to develop more testing facilities in different centers. So this is the and then DVT-IBSD is supporting that Jawaharlal Nehru Institute of Medical Sciences IMPHAL providing that work, and then in fact, a team of trained scientists in the beginning with the Jenin Center, and then again supporting the Regional Institute of Medical Science REIMS as IMPHAL with the RT-PCR and even that with the RNA extraction machine. And in fact, these both the centers has been doing very well on that, and by that way, the IBSD has been helping in every way for establishing those things. And in IBSD has been facilitating the establishment of the COVID testing center in Pasteur Institute. The scientists at Meghalaya IBSD, they have been working, and in, as I told that recently, we want as requested by the government of Meghalaya, we are developing one testing facility there with Pasteur Institute and IBSD joint collaboration, and this is under process. In fact, IBSD has supported the Tura Civil Hospital COVID testing facility as well in Meghalaya, which is a bit far from Shillong, but there also we have been working on the developing the facility, and we have been working on we have supported the Joram Medical College Hospital in Aizawl, which is the only RT-PCR COVID testing facility in Mizoram, and there our scientists in Mizoram IBSD, they have been helping, and this in fact, this RT-PCR machine was airlifted by the government of Mizoram and installed, and then that has been that was a that is support what was made, and it has been working well, and we are our scientists is working there regularly. In Sikkim Center, they are also supporting the SNTM Hospital of the government of Sikkim, providing the consumables and other things, and in the and beside that, we are having some outreach activities against this SARS-CoV-2 by providing PPE to frontline workers, to the supporting staff testing laboratories by the own manufacturer hand sanitizers, and also the face masks for the frontline workers for COVID-19, the community who are getting affected workers who are working there. Then we are providing this, distributing the sanitizers to community health center and the hospitals in all the places. In fact, this PPE to the children home or even senior citizen home, and with that also being worked with, and this hand sanitizer, face masks, mineral water, in something we've been providing, being provided to the police station and others who are sometimes the people are working regularly, they are doing those things in Manipur, and this the same thing is being happening in Sikkim, Meghalaya and Mizoram as well. In fact, these things has been very well appreciated, these outreach activities in several aspects, where we have been going to the poorest of the poor, the needy people, and then helping them, providing this support on for the as a outreach activities against SARS-CoV-2 on different for the different from different fronts. And beside that, actually, this is one of the initiative what we took that with the when we say about that the use of the medicinal plants, the drugs from traditional medicines and food and so many things. Specifically, if you see the northeastern region, there are less infection at the beginning. And even now the infectious people numbers are less. This was one of the reasons what the hypothesis what we developed is that use of the food and some specific plants, what is very specific in this region, which is not in other states. And to explore that one, we came up with lot many experimental things. And this was one of the things what was Reimagine Ethnopharmacology on international webinar series, what we started with the collaboration of the Society for Ethnopharmacology India and the International Society for Ethnopharmacology Switzerland, every Saturday 6 to 8, to cope up with the maximum time zone of the world, where around 40 countries people they join. Till now we had 16 session completed, 17 session is in this week, where we are going to highlight that how best we have to reimagine the potentials of the ethnomedicine and explore the potential of ethnopharmacology, with which can really give a direct impact on the prophylactics or therapeutics of COVID-19 or other scenario where these bioresources have a great role to play. And in this unprecedented situation, when we are forced us to see completely the whole world in a very different way, this webinar series is being organized, and we are getting very good response. As I told, currently we are at the 17th session, and we have got every week international speakers and the national speakers together. From last week onwards, we have made it will be an alternate week, but throughout the year this will run as our effort with the international webinar in this specific with this international webinar series, with these two organizations jointly, Society for Ethnopharmacology, International Society for Ethnopharmacology. And here in this international society, these 21 countries people are involved, which help the things.
Can we conclude in a minute?
So I'm in the last.
Thank you.
Yeah. So and these are the these are some of the media reports. What you can see, there are over 60 newspapers. They reported all these activities in different places, in the IBH's outreach activities, which was reported in so several newspapers as well. And with this, I would like to these are in brief, and I'd like to thank Dr. Renu Sarup, Madam Secretary of Department of Biotechnology, for her very kind support and encouragement, and our advisor Dr. Muhammad Aslam, Dr. Boisali, and Dr. Manoj Modi, and our faculty, students and staff of these institutes, and for helping in developing the things with IBSG Manipur, Sikkim, Meghalaya and Mizoram. And I do hope that with all your support and encouragement, we can do more in this area for exploring the bioresources of the Northeastern region, specifically for the sustainable development in developing the bioeconomy of the country. Thank you very much.
Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Yes.
To all the three presenters for today's webinar. This brings us to the last round of the webinar, where we have some really important questions lined up for you all. Before moving forward, I would like to ask if all of you are comfortable by extending this webinar by 7 to 10 minutes, then I think we can accommodate a few questions.
Sure.
Thank you. So the first question is for Dr. Panda. Someone asked that what is the mutation rate of SARS-CoV-2 as compared to the influenza virus, and how is it going to affect the vaccine discovery?
Okay, actually the real answer Ajay will tell, because I don't work on virus mutation, but let me tell you about influenza. Influenza mutated every year, that's why you have a seasonal influenza. We don't know about this virus, whether it is like another influenza virus or things, it will mutate every year, so that we'll have a seasonal vaccine. But Ajay and others will be able to tell whether the virus or the RBD portion, which is used to enter to the cell, has been mutated. If that has not happened, there is no seasonal vaccine. If that has happened, then we are going ahead for very worst days, as simple as that.
Dr. Paritha, would you want to elaborate on this?
I think, as I mentioned to you, there is a lot of mutations has taken place during the samples we have analyzed from, say, March to June. In that, one good thing is that the infection, but you don't know that. But as I mentioned in my slide, that 20B clad, which are more associated with more symptomatic individuals. But we are analyzing now the samples from July onwards to July and August, and that will give us some results, some clue as to whether what type of mutations are.
Okay, thank you. On that note, there is one question for you, Dr. Paritha. Someone asked, is the immune profile different across different age groups in their response towards COVID-19?
Yes, I mean, as I showed you, the cohorts which we are studying, this is again the age group between 25 to 35, then 35 to 45, and 45 to 55. So those, the only limitation we are facing now is the age group wise sample collection, because it is not uniform. Most of the people between 30 to 45 there. So getting appropriate number of sample for the analysis is a difficult, is a challenging one, but we are trying our best. Maybe within a month's time we'll be able to come out with some type of conclusion. But yes, symptomatic, asymptomatic, age match, as well as sex matched analysis is being carried out.
Okay, thank you. Professor Mukherjee, there's a question for you. How the northeastern population has fared in terms of their immune response towards COVID-19 as compared to the other parts of the country?
Yeah, this is an interesting question. Actually, in fact, this is one of the very important things to look into. And we have, as I told, that we took that hypothesis and that lead us to know that there are a lot of a plant which they are using as their food. So, like I said, their food as medicine. That is one concept we are going to explore. That those medicinal plants they are taking regularly as their food, and by that way, they are getting those that immunity is being boosted, or they are not getting infection, or even infection level is low. One thing, what I believe. That if you see the food what is being regularly taking, including the fermented food and others, and the specific plants which are being taken, those are not being taken in the plain places. And we have sorted those plants. By that way, the 72 medicinal plants, as we told, that those are very widely used, and they have been, some of them has been very much reported, like one plant, Huitenia cordata, which has been reported even COVID-2 by the Chinese DCM, and it is grown only in this part of the country. So we have been working on that, and this is these important aspects even has been taken up by Ministry of Ayush as well. As you can see that Ayush Ministry has made the Ayush Kadai, means that the infusion of the several herbs taken together that can prevent you from the infection, and that works. So the same way the things are happening in this particular places in northeastern region, where they have their own food habits, and that really helps in developing the immunity. But these need to be explored further.
Thank you. Someone asks that what is the role played by the virus in influencing the gut microbiome? As different individuals will have different microflora, can vaccine develop be useful for all, keeping in mind their age, genetics, geographic locations, weak immune systems, and susceptibility to various diseases?
You want me to answer?
Please go ahead.
Okay. Please remember, there is one corona vaccine which is available in the market for dogs and cats, and that is for dysentery, right? It is available in the market, nothing new about that. So that means this virus has played a major role in controlling the infection in the gastrointestinal tract of cat and rats and dogs. It is proven in veterinary medicine. In fact, talk to any veterinary doctor, the first vaccine they told about coronavirus. So there is a link regarding what is happening to the gut microbiome and how it is doing. Still not clear. People are studying. I had some information about people who are analyzing this gut microbiome, particularly with prebiotic and probiotics. Remember, the colon, human colon has maximum number of AC2 receptors. So the chances that the virus will colonize there is very, very high. But what interesting things people have been observing, those who get dysentery and stomach upset and gastrointestinal problem during this time, surprisingly, they are most protected. Surprisingly, they are most protected. That means they got, this is an unpublished study from a group of people in a big hospital in USA. Surprise, that means these, the population in gut microbe, there are only four type of bacteria in the gut. You can always check that. So that means the microbial population in the gut has the ability to control the inflammation and other things which is done by this virus. Because most of the people who get into dysentery and diarrhea are recovering faster. This is an unreported data, observed data. Hopefully, as the many data comes, people will know. But certainly, there will be something in the microbe population in the gut.
I think just to add on that, the limited study we did with the fecal transmission, you could find the people becoming negative in also in pharyngeal swabs, but still they continue to be positive in their fecal samples. So that will have certainly impact on the gut microbiome. And I think those detailed analysis are to go to study. And in fact, there is a Chinese report where from the gut microbiome, they have cultured a virus. I mean, they're using that fecal samples, have cultured a SARS-CoV virus. I think it will be great to analyze the genome composition between those two strains.
You see, in the actual way, this virus was, the virus habitat was the gut of the bat. It was staying in the bat gut. We killed the bat, so the virus came out and spread. So this is a natural habitat. So something has to be studied in detail. No doubt about that.
Thank you. Very insightful. So the next question is for Professor Mukherjee. Someone asks that in the Northeast, there are there any leads from the traditional medicines or bioresources against COVID-19?
Yeah, there are. Definitely, there are several leads, but those leads has not been what I should say that discovered as drug or something like that. These leads are provided by the tradition, which is being used by the people as lot. What I told earlier, from the food, what they are taking, or the medicinal plant, what they are taking as infusion, and they are very much useful by the common people, and they are getting help out of it. But scientific evidences on this need to be explored further, on which in fact with IBSD and other institutes like jointly with ILS or RCB, we have been working with making that extracts, their fractionations and evaluations of those antiviral components. But there are several leads from Northeastern medicinal plants, which definitely can be explored further for developing therapeutics for and as against antiviral. There are a lot of scope, a lot of leads available.
So this question is for all three of you. What are the different risks associated with COVID-19 vaccine? And this halt in one of the vaccine trials, is it something of serious concern or is it a routine practice?
I think Dr. Panda.
Okay. So first of all, please remember, these are candidate vaccines. These are not vaccines. Please remember that. It is pushed by people. We hope one of them will be successful, but these are candidate vaccines. And chances that someone may work. Please understand also, for each disease, we have only one vaccine. Whether it is DT, TT, smallpox, measles. Here, for the first time, for a single disease, we may have multiple vaccines, a DNA vaccine, RNA vaccine. We don't know which will work. But what has been reported in the Oxford trial, it was anticipated because this is a virus and sequence. And if you remember in one of my slides, say, real report will come when you do a phase 3 clinical trial on endemic population and varied population with different age group. If you see the Russian vaccine, I'm not complaining or criticizing. The Russian vaccine is showing titer, but the experiment was done with military people whose age is 20 to 35. And this virus doesn't affect much of these younger people, neither old people. So how much that data will be useful for older people is a question. Same way, whatever the complication has come in this report, this is serious, no doubt about this. But please remember, these are part of phase 3 trial. There is a something called DSMB, Drug Regulatory Board, Monitoring Board. They review it. The whole purpose of DSMB in any clinical trial is expect some abnormality during trial. Think over this, analyze. It's something like that, no pain, no gain. Unless you get into trouble, you will not get anything. So these are expected. But because of the hype, because of newspaper things, these are highlighted that it is stopped. Nothing like that. However, the conditions and the implications is serious. But I hope the DSMB will look very carefully, look for an alternative or look for a solution so that at the end of the day, a safety vaccine. As I told you, what is most important in a vaccine is safety. That's all. We all know it produced titer, it gave antibody, but safety is important. That's why this phase 3 trial, and it's good that this problem has come. The sooner they clear it, things, it will restart. I hope I am able to convince a little bit.
Thank you. So on that note, one last question. Will SARS-CoV-2 become part of us, or will we be able to eradicate it from us? Big time.
Oh, that is a big question.
That will require another 20 webinars to find out.
Let me tell you, if you look at the whole biosphere of the world, we have a huge number of living organisms, plant, animal, insect, bacteria, virus. There are 1 million virus species, 1 million species. And one of them is coronavirus. Until now, we know only 7. 4 are very mild, don't do anything. 3 only we know. This is one, this is the third one. So we have evolved with the virus. All, whether it is corona or something else, we will be living with virus. Whether we will be able to, that will make dent on your body, our immune system will develop, only time will tell. But we have to live with the virus anyway.
Thank you. Any last words from you, Dr. Parida?
No, that's fine. Let's hope the pandemic goes away, but I think there is no option but to live with the virus.
Yeah. Would you like to add anything, Professor Mukherjee?
No, it's okay. It's good. Thank you very much. And we had very good discussions all together. But definitely, as Dr. Panda and Dr. Parida said, that we have to live with the virus, but in fact, we have to do our work and let us expect for a very potential vaccine. And obviously, besides that, we also have to have our other therapeutics developed to the extent so that we will not get the disease. So that is the expectation. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You have all summed it up for me. Thank you so very much. A very big thanks to all the three panelists for joining us today. Before I end, I'll just request you all to please fill in the feedback form that you'll be redirected to after I end this session. And you can follow the DBT social media to get more information using these handles. And with that, this brings us to an end of today's session. I would like to thank you all for joining us today, and please take care and stay safe. Thanks a lot. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.